Hey everyone, my name's Drew and we are here. This is going to be week number 2 of the Galar Defenders League. And I apologize if this comes out late. This match is being played super late and there's just a whole bunch of stuff going on. And I don't know if I'm going to be able to get it out on time, but hopefully it'll be out really, really soon. This is going to be against Leo 6FootHax. He's a good friend of mine and I'm trying to keep the winning streaks going from our Uno games late at night. So hopefully things will work out for me here. But he has a very, very scary team. And a few things that I was looking at a lot. I mean, obviously he has the Mew that can choose any way that it wants to set up. That's going to be a huge thing to try to not lose to immediately. He has a G-Max Copperajah, which I know how scary Copperajah can be. But the mon that I'm looking most at is honestly this Scolipede, which is crazy because there's so many mons that I love, like the Mamoswine here. And Gudra is super scary. Gudra is going to be difficult for my team to manage no matter what happens in this matchup, right? But I felt from the beginning, right, that if anything was going to beat me, that it was going to kind of be the Scolipede. So I kind of had to find a few ways to not lose to it. So first of all, he has an upper tier of speed that is very strong, right? So he didn't bring the Starmie, he didn't bring the Cinderace, and I didn't bring my G-Max Cinderace, which could have probably helped out a bit in this matchup. But regardless, I still kind of like my matchup. But I think my entire matchup is going to ride on whether or not my NECROZMA can come through. So everything here is going to be supporting my NECROZMA. You can see I have three choice scarfed Pokemon. Between the Serena, which I love Serena to death, the Primarina, and the Primarina can't even touch like the upper tier of his speed tiers. But even having a Scarf Primarina to kind of hit that like Mamoswine level and outspeed everything Mamoswine and below, can kind of really put a lot of dents into the team. And again, it's going to be all about supporting the NECROZMA, because my NECROZMA is a Tangaberry NECROZMA with Iron Defense, Calm Mind, and Stored Power. And I feel like if there's any chance that I'm going to have to win this matchup, it's going to be through this NECROZMA. And I really kind of like this Tangaberry situation, because obviously, like, if he starts getting spicy and going for some raw Mega Horns into my NECROZMA, then I can take the first one, I can Iron Defense up on that one, and then from there, secondary Iron Defenses are pretty free. I can build up my Stored Powers and eventually be able to take that out reasonably easily. I don't know. It's going to be tough to tell, but I should be able to take it out without too much after, if I can get that Tangaberry to work for me there. And yeah, the Weezing is just here to kind of eat hits as well. Hopefully not lose to that Scolipede. But yeah, everything on this team is about not losing to Scolipede and being fast and getting chip damage off so that my NECROZMA hopefully has a decent time here. And I also really like Iron Defense NECROZMA here for that G-Max Copperajah, because it can just set up Iron Defenses for absolutely free up against that Copperajah, and it's just going to be doing less and less damage. And it's going to take me a while to kind of build up my Stored Power to be able to Oko it. Once I start building up my Iron Defenses, then it's going to be doing very, very little damage. And hopefully I can use that to my advantage. I can take advantage of his G-Max and not just immediately lose to it. So that's going to be the overall strategy. I'm going to get right into this matchup. Oh my god, and one thing that I completely forgot to mention is a big thank you to Nate, aka Galvanate, for recording this match for me. I had to play through him. So basically, we were in a Discord call and I was telling him what to do. So honestly, I played quite a bit faster than I normally would because of the situation. I don't think it really affected too much. I really felt confident in the way that I played this matchup. But yeah, big shout out to Galvanate. We just had so many issues trying to connect to via the LAN timers, so we just had to figure something out, and thankfully Nate was there in a call with us when we were trying to figure it out. But here we are. I kind of did expect this Mamoswine lead, so I kind of felt like the Primarina could be the best anti-lead that I had available to me. Like, I could bring in the Serena as well, but Serena could be taken advantage of. I felt like this would be the best opportunity to just get a potential flip turn off, and I kind of was uneasy about going for the turn one flip turn if he just wants to get up rocks, or if he's sashed and just doesn't value Mamoswine too much in this matchup. But he does go right out into the Trevenant, which was really solid for me. I believe that's my first time ever using flip turn, and I've been trying to save it. I've been trying to not even see the animation until recently, but there we go. There's my first flip turn of the season. Successfully beat it in something, and I'm able to get in this Obstagoon here. And here, I don't know exactly what he's trying to do here, but my thinking is to go for this parting shot here, just to try to get some more momentum. I think he's going to kind of value this Trevenant. I don't really know what its main objective here in this matchup is, especially against the mons that I have here. But I could definitely just see it as a mon that could deal massive chip damage to my Necrozma and stop from getting it too out of hand in terms of a lot of kind of setting up that it could do, right? Like, it could help, it could get a lot of chip damage off for the Mew to kind of deal with it, for a number of mons to deal with it later. So I go for the parting shot. He does not switch out, so now I am very, very confused as to what I want to do here, because something is going to take a really, really strong poltergeist potentially, and I really don't want that to happen. But this is kind of what I brought my Weezing here for. So I go into the Weezing. He goes for the Drain Punch, which kind of surprised me, but it does 7 points of damage, which honestly means that my Rocky Helmet is going to be doing more damage than he did with that Drain Punch. And at this moment, I just feel like this is kind of the moment just to go for Toxic Spikes and try to feel out what he wants to do, whatever he wants to switch into. I don't remember if this is one of the turns where I kind of felt what he was going to go into and was already talking to Nate like a turn ahead of what I wanted to do. I tried to do that quite a bit in this matchup because it felt kind of necessary here, but at the same time, it was a really kind of stressful situation because I really didn't want to lose any of my chest timer to kind of telling Nate what I wanted to do. So my mind was going like a mile a minute, just trying to figure out a whole bunch of plays, and I was trying to do it like during the animations or during these dead periods, but it's always been really difficult for me. I really like to take one turn at a time, and trying to think this much ahead it came unnaturally to me. But here we go. He does go into the Mew, which puts him in a really, really solid position, but I was trying to think over here. I don't think I expected the Mew to want to come in exactly, but I was trying to decide whether or not it was worth it to kind of switch out and potentially give him a free turn of setup, or just give this thing up for some damage and try to manage it with whatever wants to come in. But the potential for Dragon Dancing here was really strong here, and I really didn't want to allow that to happen. I do go straight into the opposite, and he goes for the Nasty Plot, so my immediate fear is that he has the Aura Sphere or something that could just destroy me right now. But he didn't boost his speed, which means I will be able to get one strong hit off. I am able to like knock off, but it's not going to matter the most, because in just a second he will reveal the Cobra Berry, and obviously you knew that the Obstagoon was a potential possibility here, and it kind of really hurt my damage output here, and just had the Bug Buzz. So a +2 Bug Buzz is just going to blow me back. But I got a bunch of damage off. Obstagoon did a lot of what it needed to do. Again, it's just clearing the way for the Necrozma in my mind still. That's what this entire match is going to be about. And this will allow me to go into my Serena, I believe, and click U-turn and kind of manage this thing. But it would have revealed Scarf, and I believe I was running some calcs, and I believe I was like telling Nate what I was thinking of. So he's like kind of clicking around these menus. But my thinking was, I was looking at these calcs, and they weren't quite where I needed them to be. So I ultimately decided to go into Primarina, and I thought that I might have to give up the Primarina here and force some damage. But I was trying to think through the order of operations, right? So would it be more worth it to U-turn out and potentially give myself some chip damage, potentially sack something off, and then bring in Serena, U-turn again, and then kind of deal with it that way? Or try to manage it some other way, trying to sack something else off. So I bring in the Primarina, and these calcs also weren't looking the greatest to me here. But I felt like this was the necessary damage, and even if I have to give up the Primarina to do it, ultimately it's probably going to be in my best interest. As unfortunate as it is, I love the heck out of Primarina, and I think it had a lot of value still in this matchup, but If some damage on the Mew is where it has to go down, I guess there's not really a whole heck of a lot that I can do about that. He does end up going for the Psyshock, which does very nearly take me out, but it doesn't, and in fact, it puts me into Torrent range, which I didn't realize in the moment, but Leo told that to me later, and I was like, oh, of course. And not only that, but I get the burn, which will be able to take this thing out without giving out my Primarina. So I do have a sack in the back if I do choose to keep this thing, or I can just get some momentum going by making him reveal what he wants to go into, potentially getting a little bit of damage off, kind of managing his team that way. But that Primarina was so clutch in that moment, taking that hit, being in Torrent range, and getting the burn, getting the KO. I love Primarina to death. So let's see. In comes this thing, so I really didn't want to switch out, try to get some momentum going, but I kind of felt like he couldn't Swords Dance, right? I had to prevent the Swords Dance no matter what happened. So I had to figure out how to do that. And I just felt like attacking, potentially getting a burn here, would be the way to go. He just took me out, but we prevent the Swords Dance, which is the biggest possible deal in this situation here. And now, I have to try to figure out what to do. And, looking back on this, I don't particularly know why I didn't just try to go into Weezing. Maybe I thought the Weezing would be too obvious, or that Weezing didn't have enough damage output, but at the same time, a conventional set doesn't really touch Weezing at all, so, either way, I go into my Sand Slash, and I figure that Sand Slash is still going to be able to kind of get the knockoff off. It's going to be able to get rocks up, it's going to be able to get hazards up for this later game. But honestly, if he had gotten super duper aggressive and gone for some crazy Swords Dances, he could have beat me right here. I don't quite know. I brought the flamethrower on the Weezing for this reason, and it's not like, you know, flamethrower is gonna Oko or anything, obviously, but it could have at least kind of managed it and not allowed him to Swords Dance up to infinity. So this is a misplay on my part for sure, looking back on it, but it kind of worked out. He just ends up switching out here as I get up my rocks, spoiler alert for 2 seconds in the future, but this honestly surprised me in the moment, and I did identify, like, in the moment that it was a misplay, but I was kind of just at a loss for what to do here. And potentially I probably should have just come in with a more solid game plan than what I did have, if the, you know, Scolipede did want to come in and start wrecking shit. But again, I was just at a loss in that moment. I was just kind of like deer in the headlights. And here's a situation where I didn't know what to do again, but I got the rocks up, and I felt like it was time to kind of give this thing up. Like the Sandslash didn't really have much in the way of value moving forward, so I wanted to get up a layer of spike here. And this was honestly me just asking Nate, like, can you go to the Pokemon menu again, because I was at a loss again for what to really do here. Leaving my Sandslash exposed out here like this, kind of to just take damage, was not ideal, but it just kind of put me in this awkward position where I kind of this wasn't in my, like, regular plan of what to do. So ultimately he Icicle Crashes, and this is going to allow me to not move and get flinched, but I would have gotten up a layer of spike as well as those rocks, so it does hurt me a little bit, I guess, in the long game, but it doesn't ultimately end up mattering the most here. And it is a 2-hit KO. I was joking around with Nate, hey, maybe the first one was a super high roll, and I'll be able to take a second one and get up a layer of spike, but I'm just leaving this out here for a sack. Again, I do feel like I really misplayed my Sandslash. I feel like I could have used it a whole lot better and not kind of been in the situation where I kind of just gave it up for nothing. If I brought in the Weezing in the first place, then I would have been in an awkward position no matter what happened. But at the very least, I would have had, like, a full HP Sandslash in the back, and who knows, I could have blundered it in some way regardless. But this was not a very good use of Sandslash on my part. And like I said, I really do love Sandslash quite a bit. Regardless, we're here, and we're going to be able to do some things. And I honestly just felt like, hey, this is going to be as good a moment as I ever get. Or do I pull the button here? Yeah, this is going to be as good a time as any to kind of just go for that Necrozma here. Because I was looking at I had a screenshot of both of our teams on my other monitor, and I was debating quite a bit in as to what direction I wanted to go to, but all of his mons left were physical attackers, I believe, and I felt like this would be as good a time as any to just try to go for it in terms of iron defenses. He does go straight into the Copper Raja, which I felt amazing about, because a plus 2 Necrozma that can, again, just set up 4 free, because all of this thing's offensive attacks, even when G-Max, are going to be doing less and less, and I can outspeed this every single turn and Iron Defense up for absolutely free. I felt so good about this switch, and then this is the moment where he reveals, after Iron Defense here, I'm at plus 4 defense, like, this mon cannot do any damage to me that I can't Moonlight off immediately, and he reveals the Whirlwind. And I am just in shock, right? Because this is his G-Max. This is the mon that he needs to kind of do a whole lot of offensive damage to me. Right. And he decks in the Whirlwind and it drags out my Weezing, which I'm not the most concerned about. But I was thinking so hard in my head, like, what possible outs do I have? Because I'm never going to be able to set up that much in the future with my Necrozma, because I can always get Whirlwinded out, right? So, like, even if my Necrozma is able to pick up AKO, right? I ran some pregame calcs, and it's going to take a lot of defense boosting through Iron Defense and Calm Mind boosting to ever get my sword power strong enough to kind of take on the Copperajah, right? And my plan with Copperajah was always going to be, look, the Copperajah is always going to, the Copperajah, for the most part, I can Iron Defense in front of and I can use it to set up. And the goal of that interaction was always going to be more so to kind of use it to set up on, but I'm never really gonna be able to OKO it. Even after like a million boosts, I'm only doing like half to it. So I was never really planning on being able to kind of OKO the Copperajah, and it was always going to have an opportunity to Whirlwind me, and I was just devastated. Like I couldn't think of any possible way out of this, because my entire game plan relies on Necrozma. Like the rest of my team doesn't have a great deal of offensive presence, and in this moment I didn't, you know, value my Weezing enough. I gave up my Weezing. I thought that these last two mons would have been more valuable for this endgame, but that was very debatable. But again, in this moment I was still shook. Like, I was absolutely just didn't know what to do. I was still thinking through like all my possible like options here, because my entire week relied on my Necrozma, and it just got dashed by a Whirlwind, right? So I'm in here. I knew that he had a number of potential switches, so I decide to predict that he would want to go into something, and I click knockoff here, or I scarf myself into knockoff, hoping that it could at least do sufficient damage against the Scolipede. And the Trevenant comes in, it gets rocks, gets poisoned from the Weezing, which is going to be very, very relevant, but it does allow me to get a knockoff off. He has another Cobra Berry, so very much did not want to lose to the Obstagoon. I know he respects Obstagoon quite a bit, and I do get a crit, which is also very relevant, but the toxic damage will take him out, and that is going to be a KO for Weezing, which again is going to be very relevant moving forward in the future. But regardless, now we're in a position where I have no counterplay to the Scolipede. And I should say that the only reason that I went into Serena was because I was thinking through it, and I felt like my only path to victory here was a last mon Necrozma, right? That can't get whirlwinded out. If I could pull that off somehow, then I do believe that I could win. 100%. I'm pretty confident. And also, the Gudra was scarred. Spoiler alert. But the Gudra, its strongest move was Draco, and Draco was doing about 50% to my particular Necrozma, and again, I could always Moonlight off that damage. I could always Calm Mind up. I always had options against it, and every other mon was a physical attacker, so I could kind of just deal with the team. But I was just put in an impossible position, right? Because I either go into Necrozma and potentially get Whirlwinded out, or I go into Serena and I get trapped by allowing in the Scolipede and allowing it to kind of boost up for absolutely free, and then I really can't do much in this endgame. The only thing that I could really hope for is if he Mega Horns up, misses, then Mega Horns, and pops my Tango Berry, allows me to set up even more, and then I can start doing things. But he knows what his end game is as much as I do, so that's never going to be a possibility either. But yeah, there was just a lot going on in this matchup, a lot for me to try to manage in this matchup, and I do feel like I learned a decent amount from this matchup, right? So first of all, we're talking in the post game, and he told me that basically, like not bringing your G Max like in any kind of week is going to be a throw, and I honestly felt like Cinderace didn't have the best matchup here, and I still don't think it really particularly does, but I do tend to agree, and I do think that moving forward, I really need to think of Cinderace as more of a, you know, integral part of the team, or an integral part of, like, general, or, like my base strategies, but I just felt like everything had to revolve around NECROZMA this week, and everything did, and NECROZMA could have won this match, absolutely, if it wasn't for that whirlwind, and it was just disappointing that it had to go down this way. But yeah, like I said, I had to pray for some Megahorn misses. He goes for the poison jab. Everything's fine. Now, one thing that I did find out later on in this in the post game was that turns out that raw stored power potentially KO'd here, right? So I think it might have been a roll, like he's around the 30% mark, and like a super low roll, and he would have taken a raw stored power. But in my head, I don't really respect stored power's move because I believe it's base 20. So I wasn't sure if a raw sword power would have done anything in this situation. I felt like I needed some kind of boost up, and again, I really didn't have any counterplay after that if I didn't have some boost to speak of. But he always had the Gudra to rely on, so all he had to do was land a Draco, and he basically won, right? So still in this moment here, I was thinking to myself, that sword power wasn't a possibility here, but it does actually look like a raw sword power without any boost would have KO'd there, and it would at least brought down the differential. That would have been nice, but the way that I tend to play is that once it's clear that I'm kind of in a losing position, I tend to kind of lose interest in the kind of game of reducing differential. And if a loss is going to happen, I just let it happen. And I tend to often lose differential points for that. But a bunch of people have often said that if you're playing for differential, then you're just not playing as confidently in the amount of wins that you can get in any given season. So just win and differential will never be a problem. So that is going to be week two. It was disappointing to lose, but even more than that, I don't mind losing. But I felt like this was a really boneheaded way to lose, and I really don't like the way that I lost here. But next week, we'll be going up against SV Tornado and his Vancouver Corviknights. That match has already been played, and it was a lot of fun. It's going to be a huge, huge match. And I'm going to bounce back from this. I know I will. But these first 2 weeks were just... I'm mildly speechless. But with that, thank you guys so much for watching. We'll be back really, really soon with more weeks of the GDL, as well as some more draft league stuff, as well as a doubles draft league coming up really, really soon. But with that, once again, thank you guys so much for watching. I'm going to be once again out.